We have a verse printed for you. That verse comes from the prophet Isaiah, which is in the front part of your Bibles in the Old Testament. He lived 400 years before the event that we are celebrating. And while Isaiah was speaking to the needs and concerns and problems of his time, he was also given supernatural insight by God to see things that would take place in the future. And this verse in Isaiah 9 is one of those instances where Isaiah is able to perceive what is going to take place in the future. And he prophesies about the birth of a child. And not just any child. Just take a look at the description that Isaiah gives us. This is what he writes. "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Now, I hope you've noticed those titles are hardly fitting for somebody who was even of royal lineage, much less to be spoken of somebody who's of common stock, to be born in a manger. And you know, those titles, what they do is they reflect for us what is it that this child who is to be born, the son that is to be given, what is it that he is going to accomplish? Now, I want to draw your attention especially to that last title, the Prince of Peace. What Isaiah sees in the future is that the one whom he is promising will be the one to bring peace. Just look at verse 7. "Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end." Now, we've listened to a lot of music today already, and there's some more music coming. But I want to take you to the very first Christmas carol and to show you how it actually ties in quite a bit to what Isaiah saw. And the very first Christmas song, the very first Christmas carol, is found in the Gospel of Luke, which is one of the biographies of Jesus written by somebody who became a follower of Jesus after Jesus' ascension. And so as Luke records for us in chapter 2, in verse 7, we see that Mary gives birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in a swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them at the inn. Now look at verse 8, which kind of sets up for us the very first song about Christmas. "In the same region, there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over the flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, 'Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people,'" and thus it includes us. "For to you this day in the city of David is born a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this is a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in the manger." This is what the angel pronounces to these shepherds. And verse 13, we have the very first Christmas concert to a lowly group of shepherds who were nobodies in that society. Look at verse 13. The angels can't hold it back. And we have the heavenly chorus say, "And suddenly there was with an angel a multitude of a heavenly host, praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased.'" Now that, my friends, was the best concert ever, I guarantee you. Only the shepherds, though, got to see it and got to hear it. You know, if they had any socks off in the saying, their socks would have been blown right off when they heard what the angels sang. Now, what the heavenly chorus is seeing, what the angels are beholding, is the fulfillment of what Isaiah had prophesied 400 years ago. Meaning that Christmas at its heart is the reality of the coming of peace. Christmas, my friends, is the good news of peace. In other words, Christmas speaks to the deepest longings of the human heart. At our core, beginning with me and extending to every single one of you and beyond these walls, to every single human being who has ever walked on the face of the earth, we long for peace because you and I, we were made, we were created for peace. And yet, we live, wouldn't you agree, we live in a reality where peace is so elusive. It is so transient. It is like trying to carry water in your hands and it just keeps pouring out, doesn't stay long. And you know what? If you look at your life, so much of it, you would come to realize, is filled with a pursuit of peace. It's filled worrying about peace. It's filled with fighting for peace. And this has to do with global things. Some of you here maybe are involved in the problem of human trafficking that we have in our region. And you're concerned about human trafficking that happens not only on the streets of Portland, but maybe in the United States and world at large. Some of you maybe are concerned about the problems we have in our government system. Others of you, it strikes a lot closer to your personal home because the peace which you are after is the peace in your family. Maybe it is a broken relationship between parents and kids. Maybe it's a broken relationship between husband and wife. There's some of you who are longing for that inner peace because you experience that brokenness within yourself. You experience that you're complete out of tuneness with the world. You just can't seem to take the right step forward. The world seems to be going against you. Even God Himself seems to be punishing you. And you're striving, you're hoping to find peace. Now, we obviously see this with even the little ones, right? With our kids, where they're fighting for peace, hoping their peace would be that they can have candy for breakfast every morning. Now, if I was to ask you, what do you desire for, long for, wish for, hope for the most? These are some of the things that would come up. And yet, as multifaceted as they are, there's something that connects them. At the heart of them, they're all very similar because they're trying to respond to the world and reality in which we live, which just happens to be broken. And no matter what you or I, people before us, people after us do, they can't seem to put it back together. There isn't enough breakthrough drugs available in order to set right the brokenness that is within us. There isn't enough societal structures to put in place to make sure that there's no broken families. There's no world power to dominate to make sure that there is such a thing as world peace. In other words, the deepest longings we have, in some sense, are unable and haven't been able to be met by anything that people over the millennia have accomplished and pursued and done. Now, why is it that when the angels finally break forth in song, why is it that they are focusing on the reality of peace? You see, they're praising God for one specific thing in their song. They're saying, glory to God in the highest. Basically, why? And peace. Peace among those with whom He is pleased. They're honing the attention of their song and our attentions on this idea and reality of peace that has come with the birth of Jesus. In other words, why is peace at the heart of Christmas? Why are they so sure that Jesus has brought it? And how do we tie that all in together with our modern day experience 2,000 years later? This passage, if we reflect on it, helps us consider three things. Number one, why do the angels celebrate peace? Number one, it's because God has come. In the person of Jesus Christ, God Himself has come. You've probably noticed this was our intro song, the very first song, the chorus. You've noticed this, repeated over and over, God has come. If you remember in the Isaiah prophecy, the child to be born, the son to be given is called what? Mighty God. Daniel read to us from the Gospel of Matthew, and Jesus is called Emmanuel, God with us. If you turn in the Gospel of Luke a page over to where Mary is given the promise about the baby that she will be pregnant with, in verse 32, the angel tells her, He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The idea of the Son of Most High is not so much that Jesus is created. It has to do in the ancient world, that title, Son of the Most High, had to do not so much with creation, but with equality. It didn't have to do with beginning, but with status. If you remember later on, Jesus would be crucified for this very same reason. What is it that pushes pushes everything over the edge? What breaks the camel's back for the Pharisees? It's the fact that Jesus considers himself the Son of God. Not that he considered himself a created being, but God himself. Heaven sings not because a human savior has come, like Muhammad or somebody else, but because a divine savior has come. Now, this is significant for Christmas because in Christmas we are celebrating the coming of the one and only one who could truly accomplish what he has promised, and that is peace. In other words, in Christmas we see and we celebrate the fact that God has come into the broken world so that he himself could restore that world. In other words, when we celebrate Christmas, the reason we're celebrating the coming of God is because our hope for the fact that everything will be made right and all the wrongs will be righted and all the crooked sticks will be made straight and justice will be served has to do with the fact that God is the one who is here coming to accomplish it. Now, that is what is so staggering about the story of Christmas. When we look in the manger, friends, we see nothing less than God Himself lying there as a newborn baby. So that's the first reason why the angels are celebrating peace, is because God has broken into the brokenness of the world in order to fix that. You'll ask, where do you see that? This is point number two. The angels are singing not only because God has come, but because a Savior is born. This day, verse 11 to 11, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. The mission for which God has come into the world is to bring salvation. The world, you and I were broken, and God has come to fix that. Now, you wonder, what is the nature of that brokenness? What is the reality of that brokenness that cannot be fixed, and why is it that God can only fix it? The Bible's answer is very clear. The problem lies not outside of us. In other words, what is missing is not some new esoteric knowledge. It's not a breakthrough in medicine, in education, in political science. It's not a breakthrough in religious toleration. It's not a breakthrough of racial inequality being solved. The problem that God has come to fix is the problem which is at the heart of every single person, and that is every single person who's born to this world has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, is infected with the disease of sin, which makes us deaf and crippled in relationship to God. The Bible presents God as the source of life. If you remember in the book of Genesis, God takes the clay from which he's formed Adam, and this lifeless piece of dirt becomes Adam when God breathes his breath into him and animates him and gives him life. In Genesis chapter 3, during the fall, man chooses to follow his own way and rebel against God, thus cutting himself off from the source of life. And the story of Old Testament unfolds in such a way that we see the depth of this depravity. Kings are unable to bring in Eden back. The law of God, external to human beings, is unable to fix them. They wax and wane in their allegiance, obedience, faith to their God. And ultimately, the world is broken. You see, we cannot truly appreciate what Christmas is until we come face to face with the reality of our brokenness and our need to bring salvation to us from outside of us. See, the world around us is trying to tell us, no, the problem is not in you. The problem is always out there. The problem is always in those people, in those organizations, in those political views, in those approaches to life. The problem is not in here. If we fix them. And thus, the world continues on the path of fighting and disagreeing, while at the same time, every single one feels the absence of peace, feels the reality of brokenness, and the reality of the fact that day by day, it's hard, and not only hard, but impossible to fix that. You see, the salvation that is promised here in the Savior is not that Jesus brings in a new form of teaching. It's not that Jesus brings a new 10-step plan or 12 rules for life that will now finally make you happy and bring you peace. One of the letters in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul, a follower of Jesus, says, "He himself is our peace." See, the salvation that is promised here is about the salvation that begins where things are most broken, and that's inside. The salvation of Christmas is the fixing of your soul. It's the rebirth, in the language of the New Testament. It's the new birth of your soul. God has come and taken on flesh and became a human being so that he would die on the cross to make a way possible for your soul and for my soul to be fixed, to be delivered from sin. As long as you focus on the outside, you will never attain for the peace that you are looking for and longing for on the inside. So the angels celebrate the fact that a Savior is born. And number three, they celebrate and they sing because a king is enthroned. A king is enthroned. The angel gives the title, "Who is Christ the Lord?" Christ was not Jesus' last name, if you did not know. Christ was a Hebrew title for somebody who is anointed. Most commonly in the Old Testament, these were kings, people who would sit on thrones and who would rule over their people. Lord is the Greek equivalent to that in some sense. It's the word kurios. And in the ancient world, people would say Caesar is Kurios, Caesar who was the ruler of the then known world. In other words, what the angel brings here together when he says Christ the Lord is not simply like a last name with a title that applies to a small dominion. He's bringing together Hebrew and Greek thought and saying Jesus is the king who's going to sit on the throne and who's going to rule. In other words, he's bringing a kingdom. He is bringing a new stage in human development. The king has come, the one who would be in charge. Now, how does this relate to Christmas? One aspect that I want you to highlight is that while Christmas is about God coming, and Christmas is about salvation being brought in the face of the Savior, when we talk about Christmas as the coming of the king, we've sang about this, we're talking about the punishment and justice of his enemies. The responsibility of the king is to rid his kingdom of all those forces that are opposed to his kingly rule. Silly illustration, maybe this will click with some of you. If you have small kids, you've probably seen the cartoon Lion King. And if you remember, at the beginning of the cartoon, Mufasa, who's the king, is teaching his son. And on one occasion, he has to run away because the hyenas are getting into the kingdom and he has to punish them. What happens when Mufasa dies and Simba is exiled? Disney illustrators that did a very good job with this. They turned the colors, the green colors, and the beautiful flowering trees and everything into dark and dreaded place that where there's no food, there's no harmony, it's all broken. What happens when Simba comes back? What does he have to do in order to reestablish harmony and beauty and prosperity and flourishing? He has to cast out the hyenas and the usurper, Scar, and only then can everything flourish. Now, with the coming of God, we have the inbreaking and the coming of God to judge Satan, who's the father of lies and who's the ruler of this world, but also all of those who would oppose this kingly rule. You see, in Christmas, we see that we're faced not only with the decision, are we going to celebrate Christmas as Christians or Jews or Muslims or Buddhists, or we're not going to celebrate it at all? Christmas puts us right up against a decision of how we're going to respond to the king who has been just enthroned and who will vanquish his foes, who make peace impossible, and who will punish them and throw them into the eternal pit. How will you respond to this message? In Luke 2:15, when the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in the manger. We're hoping that as you are here with us, as you're listening to this music, if you're a follower of Jesus, if you know your sins have been forgiven, if you love Jesus, we hope that along with the shepherds, the concert helps you come and see the baby once again who is king, the baby once again who is Savior, the baby once again who is God. In the midst of all the busyness of the Christmas season, you learn to align and you reflect and you align your lips with your life. It causes you to say, is my life built around this king? Am I living in accordance with the calling to which I have been called? Now, friend, this concert is for you also if you are not a follower of Jesus. You see, Satan and sin has been judged on the cross. He is defeated. D-Day is over. And in his love and in his patience, God is choosing to extend the time before final judgment is rendered. Christmas invites you to look at the manger and to realize that we're not simply praising the greatest leader in the world who's ever lived, the wisest philosopher, a profound humanitarian, an explosive revolutionary. But in Christmas, we come face to face with God, who says, come and let me give you my peace on the inside, which will flow out into eternity for all the world. Or reject and know that the level of disharmony and disunity and peacelessness that you experience will be only magnified when I come back and ask you, how did you respond to my message of peace to you? Let's pray together. If I can have you stand. Father, we thank you for the good news of peace that Jesus has brought to us. He is at the heart of Christmas. And we love him and we're drawn to him because of who he is and what he has done. And Lord, we pray that we may be those who worship you, not only in words, but in deeds. We pray for those here who don't know this Jesus, who are in rebellion against him. May Christmas be a reminder to them that the King is enthroned and the purging is coming to those who do not make peace with him. We pray these things for the glory of Jesus' name. Amen.